6. Sangster did not want to give Primble or his second man time to adjust to missing Jimmy O'Malley, so he caught the first ferry in the morning to Algiers. He refused Burke's offer of a gun and also the old man's offer to go with him. "If I don't come back, everything in the house is yours."
"Who are you kidding? You ain't got nothing in that house."
"There's good beer in the fridge."
"That I'll take."
The two men shook hands at the dock. Once he was in the quarter, he knew where Primble was staying, but not where Silk Giuliani was staying. That meant Primble had to tell him where Giuliani was, even if he didn't want to. He arrived outside the Lafitte house early enough to catch Primble coming out. He followed the man to Café du Monde, watched him consume 4 beignets, 2 before a man joined him, and 2 after. Sangster assumed this was Silk Giuliani. He watched while the two men spoke. Primble remained calm. Giuliani became agitated. Sangster knew this because the man did not eat a beignet. He had to be otherwise occupied to be able to resist eating just one. When the two men left at the same time, Sangster followed Giuliani, since he already knew where Primble was staying. Giuliani seemed to wander the quarter aimlessly. Sangster remained half a block behind him and across the street, reasonably certain he had gone unnoticed. He trailed the man for a couple of hours. During that time, there were any number of locations that would have lent themselves to murder. One in particular was when the man ducked down Pirate's Alley, which at that time of day was not very busy. It would have been relatively easy to take the man right in front of the Faulkner house, drag him into the shadows of St. Louis Cathedral and kill him, if he had been so inclined. He was not. After 2.5 hours, Giuliani finally stopped somewhere, a restaurant called Remoulade's on Bourbon Street. Sangster knew the place, had eaten there many times. He crossed the street and looked in the window. Since Giuliani worked for Primble, he halfway expected the man to be gone, perhaps out the back door. Instead, the man had been seated at a table away from the few other diners in the place. Sangster decided this was as good a place and time as any. "Silk Giuliani?" The man looked up, frowned. "Who's asking?" "I think you know." Silk's eyes widened. "Sangster?" "That's right. Mind if I sit?" Before Silk could say a word, Sangster was seated across from him. "I think we need to talk."
"About what?"
"Your friend, O'Malley. He gave you up."
"He's not my friend."
"Colleague, then."
"Whatever."
Sangster looked around. The waitress who was approaching was unfamiliar to him. That was good. "Have you ordered yet? I'd suggest a poor boy. They do them really well here."
"I was just going to have a drink."
"Good. I'll join you. A beer all right?"
"Fine."
As the waitress reached them, Sangster said, "2 Abitas, please."
"Yes, sir."
"You'll like it. It's a good beer."
"What do you want, Sangster?"
"I want to save your life."
"Save my life?"
"That's right.
I thought you told Primble you don't kill anymore."
Sangster smiled. The man had just admitted to working for Primble. That was on Primble's list of things not to do.
"That's right. I don't."
"Then what do I have to fear?"
"I don't know."
The waitress came with 2 sweating bottles of Abita.
"Ah," Sangster said, after downing a good-sized swallow.
Giuliani lifted his bottle to his mouth, preparing to take a drink. Moving quickly, Sangster drove the heel of his hand into the bottom of the bottle, in turn driving that into the other man's mouth. Teeth broke, blood spurted, and Giuliani screamed. He dropped the bottle and pressed his hands against his mouth. Sangster got to his feet, took Giuliani by the shoulders, and took him to the floor, chair and all.
"You're not good enough, Silk," he hissed into the bleeding man's ear before anyone could reach them. "Go home."
He got to his feet and was out the door as the waitress and another person reached Giuliani and began to ask him what was wrong.